Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the Fitton Centre for Creative Arts. My name is Ian Mackenzie Thurley. I'm the Executive Director here, and it's my great pleasure to welcome you to the Fitton Centre for our penultimate celebrating self of the 2016-2017 season. I'd like to thank Isaiah for his wonderful work at the piano today. Isaiah is a junior at Hamilton High School, and also if you come to the Fitton Centre regularly, you'll see Isaiah taking lessons here and also practicing down in the Steinway in our foyer. So wonderful to have him here, and another great example of what's going on in the school district, which you'll hear more about. A big part of what we wanted to do this year, particularly with Celebrating Self, is have people from all places and all walks of life, but we wanted to have a focus on Hamilton and Butler County, and you've seen that throughout the season. And one couldn't be touching on what's going on in Hamilton and in the local area than be talking about our schools. For those who've grown up in areas and gone to school, which is pretty much, I'm assuming, all of us, schools are at the center of any community, both public and private. They really are the building blocks of the community that we have around us, and of course the future that holds for our kids and the future for us all as we educate these fine young citizens. I am a father, I am a parent of a Hamilton School District kid, second grade at Bridgeport. Go Bobcats. So it's pretty fair to say I got skin in this game. It's pretty challenging for any parent when you start to put your kid in school. It's a big step. It's one we did not take lightly. Like anything going on in Hamilton, there's been enormous change, and there's been an enormous reputation that has preceded that. Both good, some bad, some indifferent. But for us, we wanted to get amongst it, like everything going on in Hamilton. The past was the past, the present is now, and the future is something we're building on, and there are so many positive things happening throughout Hamilton and happening through our school district. But I think it's important for us to connect with those things and find out for ourselves. Please don't tell me what the city was like in 1992. That's great, but it's not really relevant to 2017 and what's happening right now and what the plans are for the future. What's going on in our schools and our school districts? We have incredible teachers, we have incredible administrators, incredible energy in this city that go along with that. So it's my great pleasure to introduce you today to our superintendent of schools, who has one of the most challenging positions. If anybody's ever spent any time with Tony Orr, his phone never stops. It took me a little while of conversation. Tony, as you may know, was in what I have heard is the greatest leadership class, Leadership 25, for ESL. Is there any others? No, just us. And it was halfway through that I realized, I said, and you run a bus company too. And I was like, yes. And I'm like, okay, now I'm getting a handle on what superintendents. Here was I thinking it was just school books and long summers off, right? Yeah. That they have so much going on to entrust to our children, entrust to our future. It's an incredible privilege for that person. It's an incredible challenge. And it's for us as a community and as parents to support our teachers and support our administrators as they look to do good things. So I'm very excited to introduce you today, our Superintendent of Schools, the Hamilton City School District, Mr. Tony Orr.
That's not a good start. I was also worried about the air raid sirens because as a former English teacher, that was either foreshadowing or symbolism, and neither one would turn out well. So I can't stand at a podium. That's just the first thing. So I've always been a high energy kind of guy. A bird has already whispered to me and told me that people have already said, so I wonder if the speaker is going to be boring. You need to know my mother came to visit me today. Actually, she came last night. Before she made the trip from Urbana, which is just outside of Springfield where I grew up, I was trying to talk her into coming to visit. I won't share her age because she threatens me. But at any rate, my mom said, well, I've got to figure out what I'm going to wear. And this is my mother right here, Becky Orr, mom. So what mom says to me, and moms are just too honest, right? What mom says to me, she goes, I've just got to ask you. Is this going to be boring? My mother has never seen me in this role, which is really interesting. When I was superintendent previously for 7 years, we were building new schools. And I'm like 8 classes away from a PhD, and I'm working on all this building project, and I was telling Mom about it, and she said, well, Tony, you really ought to ask your Uncle Gary. And I said, well, why do I need to talk to Uncle Gary? Well, he's an electrician. He can help you out. I swear, when she looks at me, she must see a 12-year-old boy, but that's okay. I also want to recognize many people who are with me today. My lovely wife, Lisa, we're celebrating our one-year anniversary on what day? April 15th. April 5th. That is not funny. April 15th. Lisa's the reason I'm here, quite honestly. Also joining us today is Lisa's mom, Nana. That's what she makes me call her. So, Nana, thank you for being here. And then also I have Lisa's boss, Ron. Ron Whitaker is a graduate of Hamilton High in 1991. So he's from Big Blue. And he runs AGM, Architectural Glass and Metal, where Lisa works. And I'm hoping they get the contract for the metal and the glass in that spooky nook complex that's going to go in. So I get to hear about that all the time. Do you know anything? Do you know anything? That is not the pillow talk that I think is what I'm looking for. Also, I have board members with us today, my esteemed colleagues from the board office. I asked my secretary, I said, why are these people coming? They get to hear me talk all the time. And she said, well, she said they're supporting me. I think Terry secretly threatened them, but I thank them for being here today. So I really pondered what I was even going to talk to you about. Celebrating self. I tried to dissect it as an English teacher. And it's strange because I guess part of it is about me and my journey and storytelling. I think for you to know who I am and how I'm leading the district, you need to know the things about me. Quite honestly, the earliest storytellers back in the day, that's what we used to do. Before the internet, before TV, we used to actually sit around campfires. We would tell stories. We still do. It's that human interaction that we crave. In fact, one of my favorite books is called Into the Wild, and the author writes that happiness is only enjoyed when it's shared with others. That's basically the gist of what he says, and I believe that. And as we look at themes in storytelling, we look at conflicts, man versus man versus nature, man versus himself, man versus God, his own morality. We share themes of love, loss, anger, despair, hope. And that's what we do as humans. And that's the core of who I am as a leader. The earliest story that I'm aware of is the Epic of Gilgamesh in 2100 B.C., and if you were familiar with the story at all, Gilgamesh is this guy that wanders around the earth. His friend comes down. His name is Enkidu, and Enkidu is a wild man. And they have to defeat, they're polytheistic, so many gods, and they have to defeat a monster. Well, Enkidu ends up getting killed. So Gilgamesh ends up walking the earth, walks the planet, and the whole reason he wanders around is to figure out, why am I here? What is my purpose? And that's so significant. So that's what I'm talking to you today about is what is my purpose? What is my story? And my story began in the beginning. And on the left is my lovely mother. And on the right is my father, who was in the service. And then there's me. And even back then, apparently, I wore a necktie. It's interesting. I took I've got a 22-year-old daughter, and I took her, you know that thing, bring your child to work day? The first year I was principal, Mariah was in kindergarten, and I took her to work with me. And she, and as things happened, I got busy, and I'll always remember Marianne Ray, the clinic aide, took Mariah and gave her some pens and paper, and she drew a picture of me. And I still have it next to my desk as a reminder about the balance we need in our life, because what Mariah drew was she drew a picture of me in a blue suit with a green tie and giant blue eyes. And while it's really sweet, it also reminds me that that's what she saw, her dad, all the time. I owe so much to my mom and dad. They are the core of who I am. So what did I learn? Family is important. We're supposed to work hard. The world owes us nothing. You need to know that I was raised in the middle class, probably the lower middle class, and my mom and dad worked every day. My mom is a hairdresser for 40-some-odd years. And I always saw them working. I never saw my dad miss a day of work. In fact, any time that I thought I was ill, if I ever asked my dad, hey, can I stay home? He would never say yes or no. He would say, only you know how you feel. Which I think meant, get your butt to school. So I did. Compromise. I learned compromise from my parents. My favorite story about mom and dad is my parents hardly ever argued. But there was one time, and I was a teenage boy, and by the way, I already told my mom this is not interactive, so she can't argue with me about this. But they were arguing about something. And clearly my father was right, okay? I know. That's why I'm standing this far away from her. But at any rate, my father apologized to her. He said, I'm sorry, Becky, I was wrong. And I was just like, and I went up to him later, and I know it probably wasn't the most respectful thing, but I said, Dad, why did you apologize? I said, clearly, you were right. And he said, Tony, if I can teach you one thing, it's that I don't like my boat rocked. And I thought, as a teenage boy, that was the dumbest thing in the world. And now that I'm married again, I'm trying to still figure that one out. I learned honesty, integrity. I learned to have a sense of humor. From my mom, I got my passion. My candor, at times, is a blessing and a curse. I grew up in the country, so I'm rural. I have Appalachian roots. My mom's dad worked in the coal mines. So anyone that has read Hillbilly Elegy by J.D. Vance, you need to know I could relate to much of that. I survived the blizzard of 78. By the way, these are actual pictures from the area I grew up. Religious influence. I was raised in the Presbyterian Church. I was baptized in Newark, Ohio, where my own two older children have both been baptized. Later on as an adult, I served as an elder in the church. I remember the wooden pews, falling asleep next to my dad, and knowing that I had to be quiet when I fell asleep. I went to Northwestern local schools. I am the product of public school teachers, and I couldn't thank them more. This is back in the day when teaching was an art. Don't get me wrong, I still think it is, but I think it's been somewhat hampered and hindered. This is the day that they taught us to be adaptable, flexible thinkers, that they weren't restrained from standardized testing. There was a strong emphasis on reading, writing, and arithmetic. But by eighth grade, we were challenged to either go ahead and pick a career, or by golly, like going to IH, International Harvester, Navistar. Just like here in Hamilton, kids here were encouraged to go into the mill, or college, or whatever. My favorite teacher, I talked to him just the other day, Mr. Piercy, he taught us to question everything. When I became a school teacher, I taught my students the same thing. I said, question everything, but I added respectfully. I thought that was important. So here's how my educational career continued. First, I had a full ride to Ohio State University because I was going to be a doctor. 18 years old, full ride. I stayed less than a quarter. Why? I had fallen in love. My parents were so happy with me because no one had graduated from college. And can you imagine me sharing that with my parents? Did not go over well. I ended up getting married, and quite honestly, by the age of 23, I realized I needed it. I was supposed to do something. I had a calling. Just like learning in the Presbyterian Church, we're supposed to be, as Christians, servant leaders. It's supposed to mean something. So by 23, I've matured, and I know I'm supposed to do something. So I was going to go back to college. This is the pivotal moment in my life, if I were to do an autobiography. Because just as I was going back to school, and my scholarships are gone, and I'm going to go to Sinclair Community College, my dad was diagnosed with cancer. He was 51 years old. He was given a year to live, and he lasted 3 months. And I share that with you because it's such an important time in my life. Because I promised my dad as I went back that I would graduate college and then I would make him proud. And quite honestly, I blew through college quickly. I got my bachelor's in about three years. I was taking 24 credit hours per quarter. I had to get special permission. And my professor said, "Tony, why do you want to take this much? What are you doing?" And I said, "I'm in a hurry. I've got time to make up." And that's what I did. I went on from Sinclair Community College. By the way, some people are embarrassed by community college, but when I look at colleges like Sinclair, Miami Regionals, I couldn't have more pride. They gave us a chance. They gave a 23-year-old non-traditional student a chance. From there, I transferred to Wright State University, where I became, I laugh because I didn't make honor society in high school because of my sense of humor. That's all I'll say on that. In college, they asked me to be the president of the honor society. I know, that's what I said. The nice young lady here in the orange just went like that. My parents were there. Mom was the same way. Really? Yeah, I know. And quite honestly, there's a great quote from Corinthians that I always think about when my dad passed. When I was a child, I spoke as a child, I understood as a child, I thought as a child. But when I became a man, I put childish things away. That was the transition for me. And then I finally made it to the University of Dayton. Started my teaching career, taught middle school, high school English. I was the research English teacher. So I was the dreaded guy that made you write research papers. Rumor has it here in Hamilton, I've been the champion of a writing initiative. It's their own fault for hiring an old English teacher. So while I was in college, something else you need to know about your superintendent is what my personality is. I'm an ENTP, according to Myers-Briggs. I had to take this test when I was in my 20s, when I was in my 30s, when I was in my 40s. And every time I've taken it, it turns out exactly the same. I'm a 100% extrovert, which means it is really hard for me not to talk. I know you're shocked. I'm not even making eye contact with my board members right now. And it says that we like to engage in debate. Sometimes we like to do it just to be devil's advocate. And I'm not going to look at some of my colleagues. Because we will have instructional debates, and I'll push, and sometimes just to get them going. Makes the day fun. We're supposed to be more focused on the future rather than on immediate details. Terry Patterson, the real superintendent, my secretary, will tell you that's true because she has to put it on my calendar when we don't work because I just keep coming into I'll just keep coming. I'm not into those details. I focus on rational evidence and logic rather than emotion. I struggle with that sometimes. I look at data. Even though I care about people, I look at those kinds of things. I focus on that, and I if I have a plan, I just follow it. It's almost linear in my thinking. And then finally, I would prefer to wait and see what happens. You know, back in the day when I first was going through to get my master's degree and my superintendent's licenses, I had an assistant super and then the super. They were really touting the idea of doing these five-year plans. What's your five-year strategic plan? That was a long time ago. That was a lifetime ago when we were doing those. And there is some merit to it. But when you see all the change that's going on in education, as soon as you start the first day of a five-year strategic plan, you might as well start over. And we're going to be talking about that today. Supposedly, I'm good at leading others. I'm innovative, creative, and I'm logical. But I'm not going to look at my wife now. Influences on me. I love Henry David Thoreau, Ralph Waldo Emerson, Charlotte Bronte, Edgar Allan Poe, quite honestly, Ben Jonson. Oh my gosh, The Rape of the Lock. What great satire. Jonathan Swift, The Tale of the Tub. And if you haven't enjoyed those pieces of literature, those are some of my favorite classes. It allowed me to explore my sense of humor, to explore humanism. But then I had other influences in college. Jean Piaget, who obviously talked about constructing meaning for kids. Instead of us just telling them and standing there lecturing them, we want them to build their own understanding. And then there was Jerome Bruner. And if you see to the right, there's a spiral staircase. Because what we're supposed to learn today, we're supposed to build on tomorrow. And it goes around and around as we grow older. It never stops. B.F. Skinner is a behaviorist. Quite honestly, I look at B.F. Skinner, and as I look at his positive and negative stimuli and the results of the behaviors, I also think of intrinsic and extrinsic motivation. Because guess what? It's not enough that we want kids to learn. They've got to want it. They need to know why it's important to them. And that's something important. Then I look at Benjamin Bloom, who wants rigor in the classroom, higher level questioning techniques. I don't care that Christopher Columbus sailed the ocean blue in 1492. I want to know what effect he had with his voyage on the indigenous culture of the Americas. And I need kids to be able to chime in and think like that, because life isn't just Jeopardy. Thank you. And then my favorite, the father of modern education, John Dewey. And the reason I love Dewey is a pragmatist. He actually uses something really strange called common sense, which seems to be lacking at this point in time. Education is a social process. Education is growth. Education is not a preparation for life. Education is life itself. We're not supposed to quit learning. Even though what we believe today, we strongly believe in, when we read something, we better be able to change our mind tomorrow based upon that new information. The other influence I've had is my family. Top left corner, it would be myself with my older two children, Isaiah. I do not like that boy. He is 6'2", he's handsome. He towers over me. Tried to kill me the other day at Planet Fitness, working out. He's going to be a school teacher. I tried. Can I have an amen? My daughter is graduating from Marietta College. She's immediately graduating and going into the PA program. She's going to be a physician's assistant, much smarter than I'll ever be. My lovely wife, who brought me here, so you can either thank her or blame her, but she's a Lakota girl. And quite honestly, we have a fourth grade daughter together, goes to Brookwood, and I am Piper's father, and that's important to me. And then finally, and there's Piper down there. That was one day that she liked me. The other days, I make her read and do math. I am a horrible, horrible man. So my career path, again, middle school English teacher, high school English teacher, middle school principal, assistant superintendent, then superintendent. Next year, I'll begin my 10th year as a school superintendent. But my path brought me to Hamilton. So all of this my story leads all the way to Hamilton now, as I finish the last leg of my journey, my epic. Hamilton City Schools named me superintendent 2 years ago. I can't believe 2 years has gone by that quickly, but life seems to be doing that. So what have I learned about Hamilton City Schools? I knew that it was 22 square miles. I learned that we had diversity. And these are just simply facts. About 69% of our population is Caucasian, 13.5% is Hispanic, about 12% is African American, and it goes from there. About 71% live in poverty. Now, I share those things with you because it's important to know as we look at the needs of our children. And at the end of the day, that's where my heart always goes. And I always ask, is this the best thing for kids? And that's what we're all supposed to ask because, again, we're supposed to be servant leaders. We're supposed to serve all of them. So this is the Hamilton I've learned. Beautiful. There are some beautiful structures. When I drove down Dayton Street for the first time, we started looking for a house. We ended up moving in behind the high school in the Taft Place area. We love it. But there were other areas we explored too. Because this isn't just Hamilton. This is Hamilton. We have approximately 45% of our property is our rental. How does that affect the school system? 30% transient rate for our kids. Because that means our teachers are challenged. If I have you in my class every day, the whole school year, 178 days, and you stick with me, by golly, we're going to do great things together. I promise you that. But when we lose them 30% of the time, it is a challenge. Now, don't get me wrong, I'll never use it as an excuse. I don't believe in excuses. But to not recognize it would, it wouldn't be respectful to serving everyone. As far as our ESL program, English Second Language, or ELL, right now we have over 660 English language learners in our system. We service, we don't teach, we serve though, over 15 languages. Over 15 languages. Now then, that's a little different when we compare ourselves to Mason. Mason also serves a great deal of languages, but the other thing that you have to look at that point in time is the economic factors that we have. Because we have some kids that are coming to us that are also in economic despair, so not only do we have the language barrier challenge, but we also have the economic condition, and we have to get them caught up cognitively. It's interesting. State law changed. Used to be, when the kids first came to us from Mexico or wherever, name it, there was at least a cushion of time when they didn't have to take a state test. But now when they come to us, they have to immediately take the state test, and it counts for or against the school district. That would be like today, after we get done here, unless I put you to sleep, we're going to take a bus, we're going to go to the airport, and I'm going to drop you in Japan. And I'm going to give you 2 years. Actually, that day, they're having a state test. And you've got to take it that day. And konnichiwa to you. That's the only word I think I know. Ohio gozaimasu. There you go. So I'm going to be extremely limited. You would be as well, I would assert. But that's another challenge facing a school district, because we are so much more than a report card. And that's what we're going to be talking about further. We have beautiful buildings. I came into service the 18th largest district in the state of Ohio, and I would argue that our buildings are by far the most beautiful I've ever seen. We have 8 elementaries. We have 2 middle schools, Wilson and Garfield. We have a freshman building, and then we also have Hamilton High. 1,700 to 1,800 students go in and out those doors every day. Did you know that we serve 9,000 meals a day? Quite honestly, sometimes it's the only meals those kids will get. We've even, our board challenged us, and I thank them for doing so. We're even expanding it so that we're feeding the kids in the summer and even after school. Because you know what? You can't teach someone when they're hungry. So I commend the board for that. So what did I find when I got here? We were going in we had mixed directions going on. But we had a common goal. We all cared about our kids. I've never met a teacher who doesn't care about kids. And we do everything we can. We meet there. So, and when I came here, I think there was definitely a focus on social, emotional issues. Don't get me wrong. We were still doing academics, doing great things. But we have to take a different direction. Not because I necessarily agree with it, but because it's something that we have to do according to the state. In fact, if you look to the right of the screen, you're going to see the yin-yang symbol. And I think we have about half of it there. But as we move a little further, we're going to talk about how we get full circle. We have a train derailment going on in public education. We have had 6 state superintendents. I almost said superintendents. We've had 6 of them since 2011. Every time you have a change in leadership, you have a destabilization of an organization. Whether you change superintendents at my level, or the state level, it's almost like a flavor of the month comes up. And I don't believe in bandwagons, but yet that's what our teachers and our school systems have had to endure. History of testing started in 94 when my career began, and that's when we had the Ohio proficiency test. And I share this with you because I need you to understand that we're more than a report card. Although the media, I believe, controls our thought process. I absolutely believe that. I taught George Orwell's 1984. So believe me, I have my own theories on this. In 2004, it was phased out. It was replaced with the Ohio graduation test. 2009, we changed it again. And we went to, the state adopted Common Core. They told us Common Core was coming, but we were still going to be graded on the former standards that the state said we had to teach. So there wasn't the ability to shift over. So every time I read those articles and mumble under my breath, I'm frustrated because teachers are told, do this on one hand, but get ready because these other things are coming, and why aren't you ready? Well, it's because our community does care. In 2010, we had new standards in math, English, language arts, science, social studies. 2012, we saw that we were going to have a 58% drop in scores because of these new standards. Of course, the question I always have, are the standards true? Who says? Who's in charge of that? I don't know. It seemed to me that a lot of us that have teaching degrees, we were kind of taught to teach. 2014-15, we did implement the Common Core, and here came the park assessment, which stayed for 1 year, cost you as taxpayers, myself as a taxpayer, $120 million. State Superintendent Stan Heefner was in charge of it. He had to resign his position because he was working with park. Now, he's gone, but we had park for that year. 2015-16, they dropped park. And now we have end-of-course assessments or air examinations, which would be a whole other conversation. My point is we've had significant changes in public education that affects Hamilton City Schools. 1957, these are other causes of derailment, and I promise I'll go through really quickly. 1957, Sputnik. Oh, my gosh, education is falling apart. We're going to heck in a handbasket. We'd better do something to improve science and math. 1983, Nation at Risk came out. This was during the Reagan administration. In this report, it said that American schools were failing. So, quite honestly, Admiral James Watkins, he was Secretary of Energy, he commissioned a group to check the data of the Nation at Risk report. The data that they found contradicted the Nation at Risk report. You know what they were told, this group? The three authors presented their report to David Kearns, Deputy Secretary of Education, and he allegedly said, you bury this report or I'll bury you. Now, we didn't get to hear about that out in the public, but that's true. And then we had the PISA scores, because I'm always told how we compare internationally. And this came about 2000, and quite honestly, that was the next flag saying, oh gosh, American education's in trouble. But what's made American education great is our grit, our determination, our creativity, because art, teaching is an art. The new threat, and I'm only going to touch on this briefly, comes to us from billionaires, the Koch brothers, and then the newly appointed Secretary of Education, DeVos. And the problem that we are having is we have increased standardization on testing, and we're starting to look at the possibility of defunding public education. I would argue it's a form of economic segregation. And again, it goes against my values as a Christian, because we're supposed to serve and love them all. Standardized tests. Do you know we give 23 standardized tests before kids graduate high school now? Eight of these are high stakes. Some of them will prevent kids from going to fourth grade. Some now will prevent kids from graduating from high school, and if you've read anything that I've written lately, you know that right now, Hamilton, we're projecting, unless something changes, a 52% reduction in graduates because of these requirements. Middletown, New Miami, over 70%. Huh. Did the kids suddenly get stupider? Did teachers quit teaching? Or is there a problem? Maybe we ought to pull up John Dewey again and talk about common sense, these people. We are now giving tests, in some form or another, 40 days out of a 178-day school year. That just doesn't make sense. If you're spending all the time weighing the pig, when are you going to have time to feed it? Sorry, that's my Appalachian roots. Some of you are going to use that later. Huh? Thank you. Uh-huh. Don't use that with your wife, by the way. Okay? So what effect has the standardized testing done? And I know you can't see it from the back, so let me at least tell you what this is. These are the ACT scores. I can go back 20-plus years, and I will see no statistical deviation on this. Back in 2004, the composite score was 20.9, and thank heavens, in 2014, and I'm almost teary-eyed right now, went from a 20.9 to a 21. Huh? That's progress. SAT, same thing. 1972, the critical reading score was 530. We jumped to 1987, 507. The year that state testing started, in 1994, it was 499. So we went from 499 to today's standard, which is 497. So has it changed? Is it worth 40 days of testing? PISA results, this is that international test. This shows, if you took time to look at this in reading, math, and science, if you go across the board, you're going to see that we've always been in about the middle of the pack. But here's the difference. We test all kids. We teach all kids. In the European model, they determine by eighth grade if you're going to career or college. They don't test everyone. We do. And here's a great example of this.
How many sides does a pentagon have?
Five.
What causes disease?
Bacteria.
How many letters are in the alphabet?
26.
Take your time. Focus on the equation.
You're going to do great.
I love you.
I love you so much.
What if only the smartest boys and girls got to live here?
We are the number one most educated population in 196 countries.
You'll have 2 hours to complete the test. All grades are final.
That was pretty good, wasn't it? Is Corbin here? Corbin Moore gave that to me. And granted, it is a bit far-fetched. It's dystopian. But it's certainly it's certainly a reflection of where we've been headed with state testing. If you judged a fish by its ability to climb a tree, it'll spend its entire life believing it's stupid. So says Albert Einstein. Where I'm hypocritical is I don't believe in standardized testing. But when I was hired, the board charged me with improving academic performance. And we should. We should always try to get better. I've never met a teacher who doesn't want to get better. I've never met anybody in any industry that doesn't want to do better. My hypocrisy is, while I don't believe in it, I've got the community that says 15.7% of us believe that the report card is very influential. 39% say it's somewhat influential. So here's where we are right now. We're a team working together towards improvement. Not only we had the social-emotional issue, caring about kids, loving them, but now we are working on data-driven academic focuses. Basically, we become doctors. We need to be able to look at how students are performing. We break down the data. We group our kids according to that data. And we teach to that data stream. And it's very specific. It's laser-like on our focus. And the arrows are starting to go in the right direction the whole way. I'm expecting us to improve significantly. If somebody said, well, what's that number? Well, it depends. They're getting ready to change the test again. So I don't know. And another reason that I shy away from long-term planning beyond that. So are we going to be fully aligned? I hope so. When all the arrows are fully aligned and we're meeting all the needs of our kids based upon that data, based upon the idea that we have 30% transients, we will get there. But we're more than a report card. Where's my art teacher? There you are. Thank you. Quite honestly, one of the returns on investment we have is our fine arts department. If we keep going the path we are, we're not going to have the next Beethoven, Monet, Bach, Van Gogh, and the list goes on and on. Quite honestly, we've had kids win some significant awards just from their performances in art, in music, ROTC. It goes on and on and on. On our fine arts program is the best in Butler County. I'm going to have to read this because I don't have this memorized. We provide music strings, band classes. Annie Smith and Alexis Combs were recently named national winners of the Scholastic Art Exhibit. They've been invited to New York City, where their artwork is going to be recognized at Carnegie Hall. We have another student, Leo Rodriguez, who was recently selected for the Ohio Governor's Youth Art Exhibition, and his award ceremony is going to take place in Columbus. They deserve an applause. 1,200 of our almost 10,000 kids are in our fine arts program. It means something. It's how we connect. What did Winston Churchill say? If we're going to fight for something.
If we're going to fight for, what if we don't have the arts, what's there to fight for?
Correct. And I believe he was correct. We also have a school-based health center. Quite honestly, again, trying to take care of the needs of our kids. 1,104 medical visits, 482 dental visits, 357 vision exams. And this was, quite honestly, this data is old. This was back in January. They've given kids 180 pairs of eyeglasses. Look at the top right. When kids can't see and they don't have the money, the joy that they have when they get to have eyeglasses for the first time, when they get to have things that we take for granted, getting your teeth worked on, being healthy. But again, getting back to what storytelling is, what Hamilton City School is venturing on is recognizing that we are more, and we've got to communicate that and celebrate it. Sometimes teachers don't celebrate they don't toot their horn enough. We don't. We're humble. We do our job because we love our kids. And I'll always be a teacher at heart. So when I hear any naysayers about Hamilton City Schools, this is another reason I'm Hamilton proud.
If there's one thing I've learned in all my years as an attorney and a devoted member of the Hamilton and Cincinnati communities, it's that one generation serves to influence the next. The commitment and compassion that we demonstrate to young people can impact their lives and efforts for years to come. I'm reminded of this on a daily basis when I work hard on behalf of my clients, because that motivated approach to a life's work is what was instilled in me at Hamilton City Schools. I think back to the teachers who arrived early to prepare for the day's classes, those who devoted extra time and extra attention to make sure that every student believed that he or she was important and that they mattered. It's a confidence thing instilled in me very early on in Hamilton. Mr. James Brown looked me in the eye and he said, "Look, man, you're going to be a lawyer." Such simple yet powerful words planted in a young, impressionable mind. He told me that I could be a lawyer, and I believed him. So that's what I did. And I've never thought about being anything else. The combined effort of the school staff and my own drive to succeed helped me to graduate with honors from both the University of Dayton and the University of Cincinnati College of Law. I would later become a partner at Voorhees, Sater, Seymour & Pease, one of the nation's largest law firms. I consider Hamilton City Schools the foundation and the support of my success. That's why I'm Hamilton proud.
Lisa and I had the pleasure of going to Mr. Lampley's building recently through her job at AGM. And I'll tell you right now, when you go to that building, you understand the accomplishments of the Hamilton City School teachers, and you recognize that Nate Lampley sees further standing on the shoulders of giants. So how are you going to measure our school? Our report card is horrible. It is. And we're going to keep getting better on that. But that's not our story. These are our stories. Our stories go on in our classrooms every day. And I'll tell you right now, we will get better on the report card. But we won't do so sacrificing relationship and taking care of the social emotional needs of our kids. At this time, I thank you for your attendance. God bless you, and I'll take any questions.
Do we have any questions for Tony? He's very shy. Be gentle.
Rob just said I'm throwing you a softball, which I appreciate, because at 50, my eyes are starting to go. We are opening the Miami School next year. It's down on Ross, and for non-traditional students, we've had some students that might be becoming mothers. They might have to have a job to support their families. They might not fit in with the social mold with other kids. They deserve a chance too. We are the Good Samaritans. And by golly, they'll get a chance at the Miami school where they're going to enjoy a blended learning environment. What that means is, yes, they'll do some work on the computer, but I cannot emphasize enough the importance of the human touch where somebody says, how's your mom? And hey, you can do this. You can't just sit a kid in front of a computer and expect them to do it on his or her own. So we're going to open the Miami school. That's a part of it. The other part is we're being servant leaders, and we have a centralized registration center. Why should our families have to go to 12 different buildings when they can go at a one-stop shop? And again, we have to look for ways to serve each other, and that's what we do. Other questions? Any questions?
You were just talking about servicing moms with children.
Yeah.
Do you have daycare in those areas for them, or how does that work?
We don't have daycare at this point in time, but we do have family liaisons. In fact, not only do we have our own family liaisons, we also work with, we have a lot of collaborative ventures. We work with Butler County ESC, the Educational Service Center, and we have what we call success liaisons that connect families that are in need to resources. Even the idea of going to Ohio Means Jobs. How do I go for health care? What if I need groceries? The service that churches once served, we do that now. We do all of those things. In loco parentis means an absence of parent. We're the parents. We are the parents. I'm the dad, I guess. So at any rate, we try to connect people that need those kinds of resources. We don't have it in our buildings now. I can't tell you that there's a plan for that, but our plan will be to service whatever our kids need us to do. George, Mr. Johnson?
How many homeless students do we serve?
Right now, as far as by definition, according to the McKinney-Vento Act, we have 300 students in Hamilton City Schools that are, by definition, homeless. And again, they deserve a chance. That shows up on the report card. All these things do. So when people say, well, yeah, your graduation rate, this, that, and the other, there are other factors to consider. Wouldn't it be great if life were just so black and white that we didn't have to think? Other questions?
What would happen to the graduation requirements today? What would happen to the kids that didn't graduate?
The kids, if they don't graduate, Mr. Weigel just asked, what would happen if the current graduation requirements stay as the state has set forth? Which would be a travesty, and it would be an injustice. Again, I said 52% of our kids won't make it. The funny thing is, and there's not funny, the military doesn't ask how students did on their state test scores. Ohio employers don't ask. They ask, do you have a diploma? They ask, how are your soft skills? Can you be to work on time? Are you willing to work hard? Colleges aren't asking for state test scores. They look at kids' ACT, SAT. They look at teacher references. They look at your diploma. So that's the travesty. So what's going to happen, quite honestly? For Ohio, I'm going to see an economic downturn, unlike any that we've ever seen before. Because as far as workforce development, and I've reached out to the businesses and I've challenged them. I said, if you want us to be your best headhunters, we have great kids. We can share with you who they are and fill the need at Bilstein, at StarTech, at Barclaycard. Just ask us. I've even offered to bus some of them. I said, start a training program. Do it while they're 16 or 17 years old. Just like the 16 or 17-year-olds that knew they were going to go work for Champion. Right? So let's bet and declare, and let's do this and get it done. I know I'm low energy. I apologize. Okay. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am?
For students that aren't going to graduate, what will happen to them?
We don't have room for them. If students do not graduate, we do not have room for 52% of a class of about 600 kids. And remember, this is statewide. This isn't a Hamilton thing. So what happens to them? We would obviously, we have the ABLE program where we could try to help them. We could try to encourage them to get a GED. But what I think is a shame is, as a school teacher, I know much better than a state test score if those kids have earned credit in my class. I'm with those kids 178 days, and how dare someone tell me that they know on one day that my student can't perform. And I will always have a teacher's heart and a teacher's backs. Any other questions for me today? Pastor Shack.
What can we do now to help care to feel so bad and stop that?
That's a great question. She asked, what can we do now as a community? Well, a lot of it falls to the schools and the teachers. But quite honestly, at home, and let's face it, unless you're with them 24/7, I mean, even with our fourth grader, you know, I made a joke that she's kissing me on the cheek. She likes me that day. Well, I'm home with her and Lisa telling her, you got to read tonight. I'm home working on math. But not everybody's home with them. And we're working on as many after-school programs as we can. Booker T. Washington, Pastor Shack, programs we can do in the summer. Somehow we have got to connect with the community, though, that doesn't necessarily value education. Recently, we had a parent that said to us, because we really hold dear the College Credit Plus program, these kids can now go to college at Sinclair Community College, get at least a year under their belt or more, and we pay for it. You want to talk about giving kids a leg up on the competition? How wonderful. But one of the parents that was asked to work on her daughter's schedule said, we don't want to do that. We like it the old way. Well, it's my daughter, I know, but for the love of all that's holy, just do this. So, Pastor Shack, we need to talk in our communities. And we need to talk amongst ourselves. We need to celebrate what Hamilton's doing well. We need to encourage our kids. Are you going to see kids out walking the streets and smoking? Yep, just like when we all went to school. Yep, nothing's changed there. And guess what? Many of those turned out well. Are we going to lose any? Absolutely. Just like when we went to school, there were kids that didn't make it, and we love them. We hope that the seeds that we planted as school teachers grow tomorrow. We just don't know when it's going to happen. For me, it was 23. Did my teachers fail? Don't ask my mom, because I was supposed to be a doctor. Okay, I don't know. Other questions? That's it. Thank you very much.
Tony Orr, ladies and gentlemen.
Thank you so much, Tony. We really appreciate your time here today. And ladies and gentlemen, we appreciate you coming out for Celebrating Self. I do need to thank very quickly our friends at Fairfield Foodies for their wonderful lunch today. Thank you so much. To Hill and Dale Communities for our desserts, and of course our series sponsors there at the Journal News. Thank you so much for your continued support of Celebrating Self. The other thing, Tony mentioned about change going on and things that threaten our existence. Ladies and gentlemen, the NEA, the National Endowment of the Arts, is under threat. This is not a political statement, this is a policy statement. If you love the arts, and you do because you're sitting here, fight for it. For when it goes, it will be no longer. Call your congressman, call your senator, call the president of the United States. These are the ladies and gentlemen making those decisions. It's a tiny part of the budget. We need to save the NEA. If you love the Fitton Center and you love TV Hamilton and you love the arts, you listen to music, you watch television, you go to the movies, all of these are things are affected by the NEA because they go to grassroots. We need to save this. I ask you for your help in doing that. Please get out your letters, get out your phones, and we can do this. We can do this right. I'd really appreciate your support with that, as I appreciate your support here at the Fitton Center. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you again, Mr. Tony Orr, Superintendent of Schools. Thank you.
Thank you.